All right, so our next speaker from Biogen, Sarah Ryan. She'll be presenting on iPACS, IVIS Data Set Management Tool.
Okay.
Thank you,
Bill. Okay. Make sure I'm all set here. Great, okay. So I'm taking a fairly different angle from a lot of the other talks this morning. I'm focusing on optical imaging. And I actually, disclosure in the beginning, I don't have any pretty data sets to show you. I don't have any beautiful images of animals. So this is really all about managing optical imaging data. And this is a tool that we've been developing, working in a really excellent collaboration with the inviCRO team over the last couple of years, and it's really made a big difference to our group. So within Biogen, within our preclinical imaging group, we have subsections, and we handle all of the optical imaging for researchers in Biogen. So we're a little different from some other organizations. So they have a closed facility, and we do all the acquisition, all the analysis, and all the reporting of all the optical imaging data. So managing that group, we were looking at sort of the needs and issues that were arising. So the clear difference between optical imaging and some of the other modalities were very high throughput. So we can generate huge amounts of data very quickly. Then we have to figure out what to do with it, how to find our data, how to go back and figure out what we're looking at. And we also want to make sure that we are really reporting the data as consistently as we can, because we are the core group that we're working back with our research scientists. So it's critical that we're managing our data as well as we can, as well as doing the best possible analysis. So when we started about 3 years ago, we were just storing our data on local servers and sort of storing in a folder organization, and that works as long as you're really organized and everybody handles things the same way. But as you acquire large volumes of data in many diverse studies over time, finding that particular study with a particular compound that you ran in March 3 years ago is difficult. So I really wanted to work toward finding something that was really powerfully searchable. That was really the first goal that we started out with when we developed this project. So just something where we'd be able to go back and find any particular string of information that we were looking for. And what ends up happening, again, with the high throughput, so you could have a study of 30 animals, 10 time point acquisitions, 5 treatment groups, there's a lot of sorting of the data, which can become very cumbersome. So you can just spend a lot of time sort of copying and pasting and transferring Excel data, and there's a lot of room for error here. So that was our problem that we started with. The solution is what we've got come to now, a couple years down the line. We're calling it the iPACS IVIS Data Sheet Management Tool. And we're emphasizing the IVIS part. So this is for optical imaging, and this is all within the PerkinElmer IVIS system using living image software. So this is how we define it. This is our system, defined for us. We want to share with you. It's very adaptable. But this is definitely an optical IVIS tool. And so what we've gotten out of this, honestly, 2 years down the line, we've gotten far more out of this than I would have anticipated when we started out with our questions. So we have very clear project and study level organization. I'm going to walk through how this is defined. But this in and of itself, because everybody's working within sort of defined parameters, of how all of our studies are organized, this has just cleaned up our large bulk of data that we've acquired, and it's just made searching, it's just made our organization much better within our group for all of our different studies. It's powerfully searchable, so using all of the power of the iPACS that I'll be getting into, we can find any piece that we want. The piece that I didn't quite anticipate how useful this was going to be, but we came out with this data reporting tool, which is just a massive time saving and has many other advantages as well. So at the end of that longitudinal study, when you have numerous time points, numerous study groups, numerous animals, you spend a lot of time trudging through the data, and it all has to be sorted properly and analyzed so that you actually know what your output is. So that can be 2 to 4 hours on an average study. It could be a whole lot more on a really big, complicated study. And that 2 to 4 hours really is reduced to 30 seconds using this tool, so it's huge. It's really cool. Brief introduction to the iPACS and the way that we're using it in this context. So all of Biogen's preclinical imaging studies are stored in iPACS. So there's an integration with the iPACS for all of our different modalities. And the iPACS manages the data from all the different modalities. So within the iPACS, there's the project-driven study management tool fits into any workflow, the accessibility of the metadata, so you can really do a lot of sorting and screening at that level, very powerful searching, so this was our first appeal going in this direction, searching, query, retrieving, reporting, and really data mining, so it gives you access to sort of ask different questions than you would just working one study at a time. Backup and archive, and just the organization into the project structure is essential. So these are the pieces that we're absolutely utilizing for my portion of this project using this new tool. So this is a brief overview of the workflow that we've developed and how we're working through this. So we are using an IVIS Spectrum instrument we upgraded last year. So we acquire our data on the IVIS instrument. We acquire our data step one using Living Image software. Step two, the data is stored onto a local server. So we actually have a local EMC Isilon server. And as we acquire the data, it's stored right onto that server. Once acquisition is complete, we then go back to our desk. Step three is the analysis using Living Image, which is then also stored back onto the server. Step four is a sync to the iPACS, and so this sync is set up automatically every 24 hours. We do it overnight. So what this ensures is that anything that's been stored in the EMC Isilon server is always managed within the iPACS environment. So it's constantly updated, which is very valuable as well. Step five, once the data has been migrated to the iPACS, we then use this reporting tool, and we're able to, in that lovely 30 seconds instead of 3 hours, generate a report output, and I'll show you what it looks like, but it's actually able to sort into treatment groups and give you graphs so you can really get a good snapshot of what you're looking at pretty quickly. Step six, we then store that back into the Isilon share, which then, of course, syncs right back into the iPACS as well. So now I'm going to go through these different steps. As we were developing this tool, we kind of had to think, you know, back end and design, sort of modify the way that we were doing our image acquisition so that we could capture data, metadata properly so that it could then be used downstream by the iPACS sorting so that it would then be more searchable and so that we could then generate this report output. So I'm going to go through each of these steps and sort of explain why we did certain configurations, and we've arrived at consensus, you know, we've arrived at protocols that we use all the time. So in the very first step, when you open up Living Image, the metadata acquisition is really important, so the data goes into the proper places and is seen properly by the iPACS downstream. So when you acquire an image, you get a menu from Living Image of a number of different acquisition fields that you can select. You can use some, all, none. For our uses, these are the acquisition fields that we chose to focus on. And a lot of this is very customizable at this point. So for our uses and for our group, this is the information that we wanted to capture and carry along. But certainly for a different group, you could choose different fields. So first of all, we choose to use these particular fields just to add to track the data along with each image. Some of these fields are actually used downstream in the iPACS to sort the data, and some of them are really just for our registration. So I know who's acquired the image, I know which strain of animal it was, I can follow the name of the study, and that's just a reference that tracks with each image that we've acquired. The critical ones for the iPACS integration are the description of the experiment, so that's a text field. And that tracks into a field I'll show you later once it's integrated into the iPACS. We ID each of the animals, which again is also very important and it's a useful field downstream. Comment 2 is a really important one. So this is a great tool for really any big longitudinal study. And so Comment 2 assigns the time points within that longitudinal study. And first of all, it assigns which is the baseline images, and that's important for our later calculation. but then it also it will distinguish 2, 4, 6 hours, et cetera, and it will sort the data properly. And we just have to, you pick a time convention, so if it's days, you stay with days. If it's weeks, you stay with weeks. And that's actually used in a couple different places downstream. So it filters for the time points in the later analysis tool and leverages the power of the IPACS to sort and assemble the analyzed data that we're using here. And time point three is something just in our group, I ask people to take, my group takes a couple different pictures, and for a particular study, I want the picture 10 minutes post-luciferin. So I need to just know when we're doing our analysis that it truly is the picture 10 minutes post-luciferin. So that's just been, it's something that we ask to just have visible in the metadata when we get to the reporting piece later on. So these are conventions. This is defined. This is printed out on the machine. Everybody who works in my group has it on their desk, and they stick with it. Step two, which actually is almost simultaneous with step one, because you kind of have to have your folder before you acquire the image. But the folder structure is really important. And so this folder structure, we define it within the Isilon share, in the Isilon server. And this structure enables the IPACS to organize the data automatically. And this, surprisingly, was just a huge advantage of developing this whole system. So again, this blue field up in the top, sorry, it got kind of distorted in the PC, but the blue field up in the top, again, sits on the instrument and on everybody's desk who does any of this analysis. And so our folder structure is critical, it's defined, and everybody has to stick to it. And we're working in four layers, four folder layers for everything that we're working in. For our particular group, we looked at our groupings of information, and we decided that strain was a useful place to start. We have a lot of reporter strains of animals, but you, any other group could bin in any particular direction that made sense to you. So our first sorting bin is mouse strain. Our second sorting bin is a specific project that we're working in, and these are just text fields, and so this just organizes our data, you know, into this hierarchy. The third sorting bin is a really critical one, so this is the study definition. And we have a very specific timestamp, so the time always has to be oriented in the same direction. And it kind of orients us as we're working through the data. You know exactly what layer you're in within your study. And you can always track back and find the specific study. And the fourth layer is embedded within the study, and so this would be the individual time point acquisitions. And we switch around the date convention, again, so that we can kind of distinguish these different layers. The raw data would be acquired in layer four. So this only has raw living image files and the sequence files that we've done the analysis on. Layer three is a really useful place because, of course, this is done. So layer three describes really a set of mice, a set of experimental mice, the 30 mice that I'm going to track for 10 days for study X. In our server, and again echoed into the IPACS environment, which I'll get to in a second, we store a lot of associated files, so we keep our Excel files that has the experimental data sheet with every animal's weight and IDs and treatment groups and all the rest of it. We also keep our exported file, which again I'll come to in a minute, but there's a convention, so that's a CSV file that goes from living image and is then used to build the report. And we keep any other associated files, any other analyzed data files, images. So right away, by developing the system, the local data storage on the server is synchronized. It's all uniform, it's all defined, and it's all very organized. And so this alone has really helped helped to sort our data, so I can find a lot of things in this direction. Then we add to that the power of the IPACS and the searchability of it. And so I have two different directions in which I can really work through a lot of data and find what I want. So this is a screenshot of how this looks once it's synced into the IPACS. So the strain level, program level, and the study ID would be the study folder. So it's all in this hierarchy, and it really looks about the same. Another screenshot field is now looking at a specific time point acquisition. So at the top, you can see strain, program, study ID, and then the specific time point acquisition. So these are all the individual IVIS images with the alphanumeric user timestamp of when each image was acquired. What we're looking at here is the web disk view. So when you're working inside the iPACS, you can either see things as the web disk view or the browser view. And the web disk view, for a non-computer guru like me, the web disk view looks very much like the data would look at on my home server. So it sorts things into this folder organization. And you can also see that when you click on one individual image, you can see all of the associated files that are required with every living image data. So you've got your black and white photograph, the luminescent photograph, and the other seven files that are always associated with every single image. The browser view, I'll come to that in a little bit, and it would actually show the metadata that's associated with each one of these images. All right, so that's the storage and the file organization. Once the data is acquired onto the Isilon share, at some point later we go to our desks and do the ROI analysis. And this is kind of a bigger separate discussion. When we were developing this system, we already had a lot of manual data which had been acquired and analyzed using Living Image. And for a number of reasons, I think also having to do with EvoQuant, the state of EvoQuant at the time and what we were capable of, we chose to do all of the analysis. We chose to do all of the analysis within Living Image. And I think Bill can help me address that question more later if anybody's interested. We could probably do things differently now if we wanted to. But at this point, we chose to do all of the analysis within Living Image. And there also are certain conventions here for how ROIs are labeled, and I'll show you that on the next slide. Once the file is exported, we have a name convention, so it's just raw data, any descriptions, and it has to be a CSV file, and then that is able to be pulled in by the iPACS to generate the report. So for my particular set of studies, I often look at several different ROIs on a given animal. So there's three fields that I use to label the ROIs. First field is the description, so it'll probably be an anatomical area, just the abdomen or whatever other region I'm looking at. When labeling the ROIs, all I have to do is be consistent. So if it's abdomen and I write the word out, I just keep that. If it's AB, I just have to be consistent. So that's the first identifier is the ROI area. The second identifier is the animal ID. And so all animals are just ID'd simply numerically 1 through 40 for any given study. And we just have to keep it 2 digits so that it's able to sort properly when it's going through all of the ROIs. The third identifier is the treatment groups. And so we decided that rather than writing out vehicle, compound 30 micromolar, which could get really cumbersome with ROI labeling, we simply assign letters, so A, B, C, D. So if you have 6 different treatment groups, it's A through E. So you assign the treatment groups at this point, and then once the report is generated, it's very straightforward to go back and just copy in the names of each of the treatment groups. So it really just takes seconds. So every ROI is labeled in this convention, and actually, you know, working through Living Image, it's very, if you're organized, it's very simple sort of copy-paste to work through a large study. Another point that was essential is to synchronize the output fields. So once you go to ROI measurements, there's a default menu. I just had to make sure that this is the particular list that everybody in my group is using and everybody organizes these fields in the same direction because this is going to populate fields in the report that then have to be seen properly by the iPACS to generate the data. So that was just a detail piece that we figured out. And then we export with a specific name on that set of raw data so that it's then seen properly downstream. Mentioned before that this thing happens nightly, so it's kind of invisible. We don't really have to worry about it. That's pretty simple. So generation of the report. I mentioned before that we defined fields at the image acquisition and that these fields were then going to be used to sort the data in the iPACS. So now I'm going to show you what it looks like. So how the study experiment is in study description, the animal numbers are in the patient ID, and the time point's also visible. Before I showed you the web disk view, this is actually the browser view. So again, this is a series of individual images. What we're seeing here is iPACS is mapping user-defined and system-defined metadata to these SCICOM equivalent fields. And both are displayed in the iPACS browser in a DICOM iPACS-like structure. So this is system-defined, the data system-defined. I have identified the study, and that's the first field here, the 24-hour, 48-hour, 2-hour, that's the time point field that I also entered. And the 10-minute is the time we post the different injections. So this is aggregating actually three of the different fields that I entered in when I acquired the images. And then, of course, this is all the animal numbers. So with this view, I have a lot of power here. So I could select only the 48-hour data from this set and compare it to 48-hour data from three other acquisitions if I wanted to. So this is all very specifically selectable and sortable at this level. And for my studies and for the type of analysis that I want to do, these were the fields that I wanted to be able to look at to determine how to sort the data. And again, all of the associated files are here. So just by clicking on one individual file, it's all nested in here. So this is what it looks like from the browser view, and I showed you before from the web disk view what it would have looked like. Okay, so once the data is synced into the iPACS, then we want to generate the report. So as we were developing this project, our group had run enough studies that we were able to look back at our studies and realize that we were really coming up with sort of a standardized template for what we wanted to read out from our studies. And this was actually really helpful because then we could start with our standardized manual template that we had been cutting and pasting and assembling and show it to Bill and Eli and the developers, and then they could help us figure out how to turn this into an automated step. So the template that we chose to use in our group has a couple different components to it. So we keep all of the raw data, so each of the exported ROI files should all appear in there. So this is, for me, this is really useful. I can go back, I can make sure that the exposure time was correct for any given image. I can look at any of those fields, and it's all tabbed, and it's very easy to see across the whole study. So those are all sorted. Those are sorted correctly by time point because the iPACS is able to interpret the time points. So all of the data is nested in one simple Excel output file. And the summary tab was the really fun part. It was pretty useful. So we could look at the data a number of different ways, which I find incredibly helpful. So what I was asking people in my group to do was to show ROIs separately. Show me all of the individual data, the raw data. Then average by treatment group, and again, show me all of the raw, flux data for each treatment group. For our studies, we actually like to take the values as a individual percent change from baseline to account for differences in animal size and all those variables. So this was our second level of calculation. And you know, when we were really organized doing this manually, you'd probably get it right most of the time that you could copy your formulas over, but there's a lot of room for error here. And then, of course, we wanted to look at the average percent change. And sometimes we would do different comparisons among groups. So this is what we'd gotten to, and this was the 3 hours of really fun Excel work that my group got to spend a lot of time on. And we showed this format to Bill and Eli, and so this is how they turned this into the 30 seconds of work. So these are various screenshots from within the iPACS. And actually here, for people who aren't familiar with this, you can see there's a browser and a web disk. So at any point, you can toggle between these different views and see the data, as I was explaining before. The processing tool is found underneath the browser. So you just click on the processing tool. There's actually a number of different processing tools, and ours is the Living Image IVIS Report. You just simply select that. At this point, this is the study ID. So this is the whole study folder. And there are a lot of options here for filtering in any direction or designation that you wanted to filter. What we've chosen to do, I actually do tend to filter on patient's name A in the patient's name field. And each image will have a capital A at the end of the image once it's been through, once it has living image metadata, ROI data associated with it. So we're just filtering on the photographs where we've done the analysis. Just makes life a little easier at this point. But there's a lot of power here for searching and customizing this view. So two clicks so far, three clicks I think. Then you get all the data again. You get to look at all the details here, like some, all, none, make sure that this is the proper set of data that you want to be looking at. I usually select all. Next, come up to four clicks. At this point, it's now showing me different options. So this is, these are all the different time points that I acquired for this study. And so I can go through, I can pull some, all, none, exclude a few. Totally my choice at this point. And the summary is a really important field that I definitely want to include at this point. Submit that. This is the really fun 30 seconds. And then you get to this download. And the data file is ready to work on. So at this point, I have a couple screenshots. I have this on my computer and in Excel. Anybody, please come find me later. Bill has this. We can also show you live the processing tool if anybody wants to see it. So this is it's just a generic set of data that we're working off of. So I can show you in a lot more detail. This is the exported ROI data, everything, just dumped in one place. Right here, there's a whole bunch of different tabs. So this is the baseline tab, but of course I could go through any of the different time points and make sure that it's seeing the right data and make sure there's, you know, if there's a crazy outlier, what's it doing in there? So that's the first part of the analysis tool. This is the summary page of the analysis tool. So this is the top of the summary page. This is sorted. I'm sure nobody can read this. This is sorted by ROI. So this is one ROI, this is another ROI in the center, and this is the third, and it's a text designation of what the ROI is. It's also sorted, there's a column that of course you can't see, sorted by the treatment groups. So it knows A, B, C, D, and it's designated those. So it's giving me these quick graphs, and so I take these graphs, expand them, stare at them, look at them backwards, forwards, sideways. All animals raw data, averaged by group. So this is A, B, C, D, and E, already averaged by groups. So in 30 seconds, I can already tell that yellow is looking pretty interesting compared to pink and blue. So I could have a pretty quick output of what's going on with my experiment at this point. This is the top of the summary page. Scrolling down, and this is even harder to see because I want to fit more on here. The next set is to do percent change from baseline. So there's this whole set of calculations taking each animal as a percent, and it has the baseline now as a zero. That's the first time point acquisition. So it's all the raw data for each individual animal across the three different ROIs and the average data. And at this point, it's giving me the averages and standard deviations so we can go back and put in error bars, whatever we want to. And this goes on for another couple hundred rows with all the different relative changes to the different groups. So this is percent changes from group A. So if I have a stimulus and an inhibition study, I can kind of zero in on different fields that are generated within this report. So yeah, if you have any more questions, we can definitely show it to you live. And then my group takes that report. We then change the ABCD to the treatment groups and annotate and fix it up and add anything to it that we want, export it into different graphing functions, you know, take the data where we want. For our uses, we just store it directly back into the Isilon share, which then, of course, syncs back into the IPAC. So it all ends up in the same place in the end. So that's our tool. So it's searchable. So that was my first goal, being able to find the data. It's beautifully searchable. We can do date project, any other configurable label that you want to find, we can find our data. As I said, the sort of unexpected benefit of this is the standardized structure. So I've had a number of different people coming through my group at different times. Doesn't matter who's acquired the data. I know where to find it, I know what it looks like, I know how it's organized. It's always in the same structure. And this really, you know, this has helped organize our data on the local server as well as within the IPACS environment. So it sort of, it works both ways. And the data reporting tool is just a huge time saving. And it has the benefit. So when we're working with other research scientists and we're saying we can do the data better than you can, you know, we have to, and the analysis is uniform. The data output is uniform. It's a really nice, versatile system, so anything that's longitudinal, 3-time-point study is useful in here. A 6-week, 40-time-point study works really well in here. The consistency across the multiple users is really critical. So that's made a big, big difference in our group. So as long as somebody's trained, as long as they're segmenting their ROIs properly and doing the rest of the acquisitions, you know, as they're trained to do, the data is coming through really nicely. And of course, we've removed any of the operator error from all that Excel file sorting and manipulation. So this has been a really great collaboration continually back and forth with the Biogen team and the inviCRO team. We've seen a lot of Bill, talked a lot to Bill, and he's had a great team supporting him behind the scenes, and Eli's definitely been a part of it. And I know that all the others have been working on this as well, and the inviCRO side of things. And on the Biogen side of things, I'm in Shell's group. Jess was the first person who was working on the optical imaging studies, so she was really kind of instrumental in helping us, you know, think about where this was all going to be organized. And Nikki was in an IT function, but was really, again, helping us to define what we wanted.